All right. You ready? Good morning, y'all. Do we have any of the prayer list from last week? We have Richard Hart Jr.
Rehab in Atlanta, and she's still not able to eat anything. She's not really speaking yet, but she didn't need her left, and this is the child that was most affected a little bit. And so they're hoping that at least she can get movement out from that side of her body. So just keep praying for her. She's been a long road to recovery.
Becky and Jude Puggle, Charles Puggle was a member here who passed away. They're kind of cutting. But they both got COVID. She's been sick for 4 weeks, and so she's just now, but she's still really weak. So, it's so sick for them. So, but we had a really good visit on the phone,
David, you know me, Mr. Minos, and pray.
Father, ruler of all, we come to you today. Thank you for blessing us, Father, and all of your wondrous creation. Father, we lift up several people today who mentioned, and we thank you to be with those who are sick. And we're recovering, that you give them strength and recover fully, so that they may work up the strength of you. Father, we may face the best of them, so that we have a family in love and breathe fully. Father, help us in our show today and in our message. Help us to learn much from our study that is in the bottom of our lives, and help us to better segments, and we're able to be more effective spreading the gospel. We pray all this for you sometime.
Thank you, David. Today, our study is primarily going to be about Stephen. Really trying to set the stage for chapter 7. We get 8 verses or something here in the end of chapter 6, but there's more in it, and then a lot we can learn about Stephen, and hopefully find a way to apply to our lives. I just wanted to mention last week that the majority of that material came from the World Video Bible School, and that was Charlie DePalma who prepared that material. And then this week, I actually kind of changed the material a little bit. I've got, I think it was originally a sermon, because it's got 3 C's in it for the 3 main points. So it may have been a sermon, but it's from John MacArthur, who's kind of like a kind of a community church out in California. You know, I don't think they're affiliated or denomination, but they're just a great community. Anyways, that Timothy, I'm borrowing heavily from his, I think it was someone here that he had a talking about Stephen, so to look at that as well. Before we get started, let's go ahead and read the bulk of the verses here that we're doing. So we're going to get Acts chapter 6, and we're going to do verses 8 through 15. I'm going to read all at once for us.
And Stephen, full of grace and power, was doing great wonders and signs among the people. Then some of those who belonged to the synagogue of the freedmen, as it was called, and of the Cyrenians and of the Alexandrians, and of those of Cilicia and Asia, rose up and disputed with Stephen. But they could not withstand the wisdom and the spirit with which he was speaking. Then they secretly instigated men who said, "We have heard him speak blasphemous words against Moses and God." And they stirred up the people and the elders and the scribes, and they came upon him and seized him and brought him before the council. And they set up false witnesses who said, "This man never ceases to speak words against the holy place and the law. For we have heard him say that this Jesus of Nazareth will destroy this place and will change the customs that Moses delivered to us." And gazing at him, all who sat at the council saw that his face was like the face of an angel.
Here's the bulk of our verses here. That's a lot of what we're going to talk about and learn about Stephen. We know from last week that Stephen is one of the 7 selected in order to speed up the apostles' time so that they could focus their main attention for preaching and teaching the word. And Stephen will become the main subject for the remainder of chapter 6 and then the entirety of chapter 7 next week. I would say here is really one of the greatest members of this early church movement, and actually, I'll put him up there on a par with Moses, and we'll describe that at the end of the notice, but we'll get into that. So, anyway, really, really great. They were really great impact on the church, and I'm really excited to be able to through this. So, we'll talk a little bit about the historical importance of Stephen. So, here, the testimony given to Israel in the initial chapters of Acts is basically on the shoulders of Peter. He was the apostle to the Jews, and it's his testimony that comes to an end in Acts. The testimony of Paul begins and then continues throughout his epistles. And kind of in between the two as sort of a bridge to Stephen, where Peter is talking to the Jerusalem Jews, and Paul, obviously, the Gentiles. Stephen was primarily here to help out the Hellenist Jews, you know, he was assigned because of their complaints, and so obviously he was one of the Hellenistic Jews, you can make that name, so. And he was, undoubtedly a voice to them and a supporter of their group and giving a message to them and bringing them in and including them in the church. He's also a bridge between Peter and Paul because Peter's ministry was in Jerusalem. Paul's ministry went out to the world, and Stephen sort of served or played a role as the catalyst that sent the church out into the world. After his martyrdom, that's when persecution really ramped up against the Christians, forcing the church to be scattered into all of Judea, Samaria, and the rest of the world. So since after his death, the church was thrown out of Jerusalem, it left the first mission field into the expansion there. So Stephen plays that link as well. Stephen is kind of a forerunner of Paul. We see that he, in Acts 6:9, we see that he is having this, he was having a disagreement. He was talking, and that was him sending out a disagreeing with him. But we're seeing him going to the synagogue, which is sort of a pattern that Paul followed as well. In his early ministry, he would go to the city and find the synagogue and talk to the Jews first. So that's kind of a pattern that Stephen did as well, it would appear, in verse 9. Saul of Tarsus, where he became Paul, coming to pick up the mantle of Stephen. He was rightfully there and saw Stephen. It might have been his first exposure to the gospel, we don't know. But he saw Stephen early on, and then he kind of picked up that role and ran with it.
He very well could have been one of the people speaking against Stephen, and Stephen speaking against him.
Yeah, I had a lot of material and I turned it down. One of the things that came out was that it would have been interesting to hear if Paul was in fact one of these in that group who was defeating Stephen. You know, he got this powerful orator, but at this point, they're uninspired, and we've got Stephen inspired. They couldn't listen to the Spirit, so even Paul, the powerful orator, couldn't withstand the preaching of Stephen here because he was inspired. We've got Stephen's not only important because of the historical impact, the dispersion, but he was also important because of his character, of his life, and of his actions here. And he does a lot to show that the effect of a man's life or the ministry has nothing to do with the length of it. And his ministry, at least as it's recorded, is extremely short. It was a catalyst that puts the person into their next in some step in her growth. So he kind of shows to us that God can use people in any position and can use them powerfully. Stephen was the first recorded Christian martyr, not really being the head of church, but the first to follow in that path, to follow the example there. Before his death, other than Christ, the opposition to the church was threats of imprisonment, verbal abuse, and then actual abuse, thrown in prison and beat. But after the sermon of Stephen, the Jewish opposition really escalated. And later in Acts, we'll see Paul, or Saul, put a role in that persecution before becoming Paul. I touched on it's interesting to note that Stephen, we're not recorded seeing him, converting people. He's not, later, Paul is just kind of, people are kind of following him. Nobody's claiming to follow him, but Stephen, he doesn't have that to his reputation, but he did receive persecution, people might, today, be trying to tell an equivalent to somebody who's a country that's hostile to Christianity. A lot of times you'll hear that they should have drawn back, if they were a little more restrained with what they preached, maybe they could women kicked out or even, killed. But here we have an example of one of the early leaders of the church who, he preached what he was led to preach, and what the ship falls is on this, so to speak.
I just had a comment real quick. So I was thinking, from our conversation earlier about Paul and Stephen meeting and whatnot, and it makes me think of like God uses what we think is bad or what we do as evil as a good thing. And as we're going to see, I'm dropping ahead, but Stephen becomes a martyr that kind of helps start the movement, as well as being the first martyr, and then Paul comes along, kind of connected in some distance to that. But it also makes me think like God's plan is something that we can't see, but it's so detailed. Like, what if Stephen never got martyred, but would he have taken his place instead of Paul, when you think about it? Like, in a hypothetical, because Stephen was inspired. So, it's just a thought. It hit me right there when you were talking about it. I was like, I don't have a mic, and I want to participate real quick.
Yeah, there's so many different ways that God can use people, depending on the actions of others around them. Regardless of which path people are taking, you can still direct it.
I think since you're mentioning Stephen's speaking role, I think it's also important to mention he became a deacon because the apostle said we cannot stop from preaching and teaching the word of God to wait at tables, but appoint seven men. So their job was to wait at tables, and Stephen preached the word. And I think that's just an example that I think sometimes we can have that mentality, well, this is not my job description. My job description is this, and that's outside my pay grade, or that's outside, all those different statements that are made, that appear that you're in the workplace. That can happen in the church. And a deacon here is preaching and teaching the word of God. I think that's phenomenal. He's the first person who didn't sit at the feet of Jesus. He is preaching. He's the first person to do that. It shows the power of the Holy Spirit.
As I mentioned, we've got our three C's in this Bible class. So we're gonna take a look first at his character. Everything about Stephen indicates that the apostles or the disciples picked well when they were trying to find this seven to help here. And his character is portrayed really a standard for us to try to follow. So that came up from actually a verse from last week. In verse 5, we said that he was a man full of faith and of the Holy Spirit. And I'm going to kind of build on that a little bit more because it ties into the description in verse 8 from this week. So when you say he was full of, it's used in the same way as if the Bible describes someone as being full of rage, or full of sorrow, full of joy.
but they were controlled by it. So in this case, he was controlled by that full of faith. It was a determining factor in his every action. The power of that faith was due to the content of the faith. The faith is found. We'll see that in 7. I don't want to get ahead of this because I haven't finished it. But, you know, we see in 7 that he believes God rules history. And he believes that to the extent that, you know, he trusted in that control that God has. He could tell by the preaching that he had no worries for his own sake. Also, in 7, we see that he had sound faith in Jesus Messiah. And the Jesus was risen, and sitting at the right hand of the Father. So, all of that to come next week. But the content of his faith is responsible for, you know, the strength of his faith and the power of his faith. And you can have faith in error, and then we'll be able to see that faith. And also in verse 5, we have before the Holy Spirit. So, again, he was, you know, totally dominated by the Spirit of God. Being full of faith is to trust, and being full of the Spirit is to obey His control. So Stephen had both parts of that. Those were kind of his qualities in verse 5, and then in verse 8 you kind of see the effect. He's full of grace, full of grace and power is what it says in verse 8. So this grace is a result of his faith. He was full of faith and the Spirit, and therefore he was full of grace and the power. To be full of grace means that God's favor is bestowed as a result of being full of faith. Because he was full of the Holy Spirit, he was also full of power. The identity of his character in verse 5 kind of sets the foundation for those effects. They're directly related. If you weren't full of faith in the Holy Spirit, you couldn't be full of grace and power. I'll go ahead and read how he had it written here. Trust and obey equals grace and power. It's a simple spiritual principle outlined for us right here. When man is full of faith toward God and obedient toward the Spirit, he will then be gracious towards men and express the power of God on their behalf. Conversely, you can never express grace towards men and understand true power until you know the full faith and the full of the Spirit. It's a simple principle and very practical. And we see then how that plays out and affects everything else about the short term of ministry here. So we've talked about his character. And if anybody has any comments, we can move on and talk about his courage. Let's see. He had several needs for courage. 7, you know, I'm going to be scared, I'll show his courage, but I'm going to really address his needs for courage, why he had a need for courage. You see that here. In verse 9, it said some of those who belonged to the synagogue were the freedmen, and some of the Cyrenians and the Alexandrians and those from Syria and Asia rose up and disputed with them. So here's his first need for courage. He's got the opposition he's seen in the synagogues. These synagogues were places of Jewish communities assembled to read scripture and worship that began during the Babylonian captivity, because Jews were scattered from the temple. And then they kind of kept them, and it was a place where people from different areas, and if they spoke a different language or whatever, when they came into Jerusalem, they could meet with somebody who was of like faith but spoke their language in that specific synagogue. So, the reason these were kind of named here is that there would have been people from that area. There were multiple synagogues in Jerusalem at the time. And as we mentioned before, the security in Asia, those of the were areas that were going to be important to Paul, because security at Ephesus, as well, of course, just where he came from. Just kind of some interesting facts about these synagogues. They talk about the freedmen. It looks like in 63 BC,
once that power had kind of gone into Israel to make him slave from the Jews and then back to Rome, when they were released, they kind of established that kind of community remaining as the free slaves that they were. These Tyrians and Alexandrians were two groups from Africa that actually had a relatively large Jewish colony there. So when they would have visited Jerusalem, that's the synagogue where they would have gone. And as we mentioned before, there's a good chance that Saul was one of the men arguing with Stephen. Since we know he's in town at the time, and he's consenting later to his death, you know, we see that he's.
Simon of Cyrene that was compelled to the carry of Jesus Christ. Those Cyrenians are from that location. So that's a very interesting too. It's interesting to bring out that that from their location is where they met for their synagogue, like their Bible class.
Yes. that's exactly right.
Yeah.
That's or what it sounds like to
them. Several thousands of maybe they
meet together with people that they even travel with from their hometown. So.
Right.
Let's see. So then in verse 11, we see a second use for courage, which is kind of getting into these false witnesses. Verse 11. This verse says the speaker that instigated him, he said they heard him speak blasphemous words against Moses and God. I think the King James said subordination, suborn witnesses. So we know they're false witnesses. And there's even carried with it the context that they know that they're hired. You know, that when they were persuaded to give this false testimony, and it's likely that this persuasion was in the form of a financial bribe. And they were paid to say that they heard Stephen speak blasphemous words against Moses and God. And really, we're seeing kind of a repeat. It's nothing new. It's the same thing that happened to Jesus, where they acquired maybe their repute. To make these accusations of blasphemy, and that's they're thinking, well, it worked once, you know, it was when we can't argue and we can't make our opinions at the forefront, and we'll get false witnesses. So here, when you see the word blasphemy, speak evil of something that God deems sacred, and they're clearly in a large disconnect between what Stephen would have been speaking and what they're accusing him of. He presumably said something that would have caught them off guard, you know, something like the law of Moses can't save you, or the old covenant is passed away and the new covenant is here in Christ. And if you're looking if you're trying to pick apart with someone saying looking for flaws rather than listening to the content, then, you know, they think they've got some grounds to kind of be blasphemy. And, you know, he likely told them that Moses was being superseded by the greater prophet of Christ. But we know that he couldn't have said it in a blasphemous way. He was there as part of the church. We know that there were false witnesses. And we know the message that was preached by him and the other apostles, you know, the message of Jesus. So,
that's kind of a slide in the face of verse 11. He's saying blasphemous words against Moses and God.
Yeah.
And that's all it takes.
Yeah, that work on the time.
Yeah.
So
here's why that's helpful.
And the second show, saying blasphemous words against the blasphemy of God. And that's likely to come from, we saw back in John 10, when Christ says he is the Son of God. If Stephen presented Christ's argument and ascribed that Christ as being the Son of God, then they'd make the same argument against him as they did when Jesus said it himself. So, but we know that Stephen had not committed blasphemy here. And then here, more need for courage. Verse 12, they stir up the people and the elders and scribes. They come upon him, seize him, and bring him before the council. You know, we know that these elders and scribes in Sanhedrin were not happy last week. earlier, but as we discussed last week, but the people we saw earlier were still on the side of the church. You know, they wanted to do more against the early Christians, but they feared the people. So now at this point, the people kind of have joined into the mob mentality. And in the translation, it's kind of talked or seized, but that doesn't imply a peaceful transition. You know, they physically were taking them away and dragging them off. And the last thing we use courage here is because it's about to stand up for a slanderous trial or a mock trial. So in 13 and 14, they set up false witnesses, claiming never to speak words against this holy place in the law. So they've heard him say that Jesus will destroy the place and will change the customs that Moses delivered to it. We know that Stephen was, we know the message he was teaching, right? He was saying that the hope of Moses is come, the old covenant has been accomplished in the death of Christ. It's led into a new covenant, which Jeremiah had predicted. It's fulfilling the law. There's access to God and true salvation, which the old system couldn't provide until there was a perfect sacrifice. So that's his message. And had they been willing to listen to it with open hearts, we know it would have been effective, as Peter's sermon had been earlier in chapter 2. But they're viewing his message with their minds already made up. They're not going to listen to it. And so they're going to pick and choose what they want to take, take stance against. And they hear claiming that he's out, basically, to destroy the Jewish state, which is trying to correct it. He's trying to damage what they should hold dear, but he's not actually happy to destroy it. It's interesting, one probably truthful element to their false testimony was that he never stopped. You know, he probably was speaking his words. They weren't blasphemous, but he was speaking to them, and he continues to speak on him, up until the end. So, what courage to see here from Stephen. Do you have any things to add at this point?
I think that is, 13, those are like two more charges that added on to the Moses of God last before. He's speaking against this holy place and the law, and he's going to change the customs that goes through that. That's almost harking back to what Jesus has said, tear down this temple, and the 3 days I built my temple before the temple was burned. So it could be they're just taking the words that they know from Solomon's, and it's like they're using the same thing that they did, as you mentioned before, against Stephen.
Stephen
and
Paul were preaching and saying the same message, and they had essentially the same thing and also kind of explaining like their concern with their blasphemy. But we know that Jesus was basically told the tribes that it's blasphemous for them to put their own customs ahead or on equivalent with the law of Moses. Some of the things you'll change the customs that Moses delivered to us. Well, they're actually guilty of establishing their own customs and then equating them with the word of God. So, in a way, they're almost guilty of what they're even hearing right there. And probably what they don't want to hear. The final point here is it's just countenance. So the last verse, verse 15, gazing at him, all who sat in the council saw his face like the face of an angel. So in the midst of their the council's calling him an evil blasphemer, he was able to sit there with a holy expression on his face, which is in itself a silent rebuke. They see what resembles the face of an angel of God. He's manifesting the glow of God here. And to counter these false accusations, God had put his glory on Stephen's face. That ties back in what he said at the very beginning, kind of keeping him on a par with Moses. God's rebuking the council here by saying, in effect, only one other man ever looked like Stephen, and that was their own beloved Moses. The first time he spoke again. So it's kind of neat, And in addition to this being a rebuke of the accusations, it also showed God's approval of the covenant. So God made Moses reflect his glory to show the his approval of the covenant he had given Moses. Likewise, even his discovering his similar appearance showed God's approval of this new covenant. In effect, God saying both of these covenants are mine. So, in Exodus 33 and 34, Moses comes back down the mountain with the tablets, the basis for what will become the law, and he's got the glory of God shining on his face. Here, Stephen has proclaimed the basis of the new covenant, and God put the radiance of his glory on Stephen's face as well. And so this approval of Stephen in the same manner that he approved Moses symbolizes the fulfillment of the old covenant and the new covenant. So it's really a neat moment here. And I'd like to tie it in. Paul acknowledges kind of this similar moment here. If somebody could read 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 7 through 11. Paul talks about this at some point. 2 Corinthians 3, verses 7 through 11.
But the mystery of death, carved in the measure of the stone, came with such glory that the intellects could not gaze in Moses' face because of its glory, which was being brought to an end. Would not the mystery of the Spirit have been even more glory? For there was glory in the mystery of condemnation, the Spirit, the mystery of righteousness, which be far exceeded in glory. Indeed, in this case, what once had been glory has come to have no glory at all, because the glory is present. For if what the beginning brought to an end came with glory, much more will have its permanence and glory.
Okay. So here Paul is talking about the same thing, this concept of the glory of the covenant. When God put his glory on the face of Stephen, he was approving the new covenant in the face of Israel. And this stands as a rebuke to these people through Stephen. And should have been a defining moment for them, kind of a one last chance for them to acknowledge that this movement was Galileo, or whatever the name was. Gamaliel had said it was, perhaps a fear of God. How many more times could they be standing in the here? Acknowledging again.
I wonder if Paul remembers being in the room when he writes this. Verse 9 of 2 Corinthians 3, if there was glory and glory, it does not mean radiance, brightness, but it's the brightness of God. So if there was this brightness in the ministry of condemnation, according to Moses' faith, the ministry of righteousness must far exceed it in glory. So his faith, Stephen's faith, was glowing. And, we talk about someone's faith glowing. We don't even understand what this looks like. It would be like faith looking like brighter than that.
Radiance,
so bright that he had to put a veil over his face because they couldn't see it. I'm sure that literally, if you look away from brightness, it's burned on your retinas, it's burned in your eyes. I'm sure that image was burned into into Paul's memory of seeing Stephen's face.
Yeah. It was neat, and I don't know, until I had kind of gone through this study, I hadn't really made that connection that God doesn't just place his glory on someone's face frequently in the scriptures. It's really a neat moment here, it's a powerful moment.
No one can do that. No one flips the switch and turns their face into a lamp.
That's what I have prepared. Do you have any additional questions or comments? Or,
I guess I'm not really
the blasphemy of Moses and stuff like that, and you mentioned like how Moses was, you know, head of the old covenant, like they said, and it's all Moses up as his father, and the covenant said Jesus bringing in this new covenant. And I'm thinking of this day to look at Hebrews, and that's exactly what the Hebrews are that the children was. And in chapter 1 of Hebrews, is just talking about how Jesus is greater than all those prophets and all those angels. That's including Moses being one of the prophets, is so much superior than those prophets and angels. And then it says in chapter 2, verse 1, it says, therefore we must pay much closer attention to what we have heard, lest we drift away from it. For since the message is said by angels should be reliable, and every transgression of which they have received it is just retribution, how shall we escape if we neglect this great salvation? So it's kind of like that idea of not necessarily letting go of the law of Moses. Like, obviously, that was a reliable, as we saw in verse 2, it proved to be reliable, right? It did what it needed to do, but now Jesus has sacrificed himself. There is a new covenant, and we need to start paying closer attention to that because Jesus is to be the Moses and the prophet.
There's a lot of times, I know at this point now, Paul isn't claiming much of a prominent role, and certainly not a positive one, but there's a lot of times in that for us to think
about. Yeah, you look at it as a second time, but that's what we can do.
I love that the sinister. The things that they did, they had to resort to paying someone off to bring in the blasphemy. People said, I heard this thing. But they did that the second time around. I think the fact that they didn't come out with it first shows that their pride, that they thought that they could beat Stephen at his own game. They thought that what they, because they believed in what? They believed in the law. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's going to keep Stephen courageous, like you're mentioning. I think that's going to keep, they're just doing what they believe. And so, no wonder they're going to do this, but they were honest about it. When they found that they couldn't handle it, the dishonesty came in. Why? Because, no, it just is what it is. I can't explain it, but it is what it is. And they were willing to justify being called.
Yeah. You know? Well, and they did. I think that there was an extent all throughout the establishment of the early church where there was a portion where the leaders, the Jews, and the people as well, all of them, they believed they were right. And they were, like you said, they were trying to come back honestly, so to speak. But, their hearts were not on spot. We know that. Jesus points that out. The hearts were hardened, that they had other distinct wickedness in them that needed to be addressed. But they did believe they were in the right, and they were trying to oppose them. And when they can't, as I said, they could not withstand the wisdom and spirit from which he was speaking. At that point, if you can't, it's a trial, so to speak. It was never a fair trial, but when you're having a trial, if you can't overcome the overwhelming evidence, the only thing they have left in order to crush this is to make something like that, which is the thunder and hiring witnesses to point witnesses.
They were scared to go in the crowd and get really popular about sin about that. So this time it seems like maybe they changed it up a little bit and we're maybe we get the people on the side, they won't be scared of what people they report so they could testify and then the people will get around those other people that were testifying as well. So.
And it could also be another thing I was reading is that at this point, a lot of the Jews in Jerusalem who were going to be receptive to the message had already joined the church. Mm-hmm. They'd already been baptized, they'd already joined the cause. Some of them had headed back to their homes, some of them maybe still gathered here. But if your church was growing here and you're pulling the people who are receptive out in your numbers, the people that are left in the crowd are getting more and more resistant. And so, it could be that the time here in this person, the hearts in Jerusalem that were going to be receptive, they were already numbered among the Christians, and those that were left are here to put the fish, and they become hostile to it, even outside of the priest and the crowd.
I've never thought of that. thus the other crowd that said he's better drunk in Acts chapter
2. He's left because he's left.
Yeah.
Because the ones who said, we'll hear more of this, and who will hear us to their heart, they've already, they're preaching now, and so.
Within the same passage, basically, like saying people over, just spread it and then find different people and discuss it. And you see throughout history that whoever shouts something again and something to lose from hearing the word, they just repeat the same passage. It's kind of showing up. Like, Satan has the same passage constantly. And sometimes it works, and sometimes it doesn't. And all we have to do is, listen a little bit. I just think it's kind of hilarious. Like, it's a spinning circle. It's like, okay, they're hearing the word, how we talk to them, what to do to them, didn't work. They say to the people, oh, that didn't work. What do we do? And it's like a constant. It's a constant.
But throughout it is difficult, and we're going to see in here, we're just in Jerusalem primarily at this moment. And so it's kind of on a small scale. But we're going to see this play out throughout the centuries as the church expands to all corners of the globe. You know, we see. Some in the community or somebody in the church will come go into an area that haven't heard the gospel. And you see the same thing. You've got people that are receptive, you've got people that aren't. Those that are receptive join, those that are not receptive try to put up barriers to keep their way of life because so that they people aren't receptive to the gospel because it would require them to change. And so the conviction of their sin and requiring them to sin no more. So they set up barriers and then you get the conflict. And so we're seeing all of that play out in Jerusalem, and it's going to be a pattern that's followed for a very long time. It's interesting what time is this thing? I don't know if it's really interesting. There we go. On the dot. Do you have a close list of prayer?
Not very long. I think I've finished there with me before. Many blessings you've given us. I'm sorry to look on the bright side of life, to count the blessings that we have, to always be grateful and thankful. To give us our sins, help us to always strive close to you, help us always read your word, and pray daily. Help us as we go out today and take these lessons in our lives, help us to apply them. To show others the light within us in Christ's name.